And today we are very honored with us for Senator Charles Grassley to take time out of his busy schedule to come to Iowa State to talk about the express purpose of the space program and space exploration in general, and what his views on it are on it, and in general and in particular is dealing with NASA, commercial space programs, and international programs, and how they relate to the United States as well as us here in Ames. And we're going to get his views on particular programs and in general, and then everybody in the audience is going to have an opportunity to ask questions. And so feel free to participate. This is hopefully going to be a very interactive session. And without further ado, I'd like to introduce Senator Charles Grassley.
Thank you very much for the invitation. Thank you as well for being patient as a group, and particularly your officers who since last summer were trying to get me to come to the campus to visit with you on this very subject that we're visiting about today. Thank you for understanding the fact that I could not be here in October because of the extended session of the Congress. I canceled for some date certain that we had set in October. I appreciate that very much. Today is kind of Iowa State University Day because I came from a meeting in Waterloo sponsored by the Iowa State University Extension Service. That meeting was on the subject of agricultural problems, international trade, probably a whole six-hour conference that I should have been at for the entire day because there were a lot of subjects there of value as a resource for me as a United States senator. In the meantime, I came down here to visit with you, and I was there as their luncheon speaker. A meeting like this is of little value if I don't listen to your concerns about space programs, particularly since you were so good to invite me to be a resource person for you. I do have a presentation asked to address some specific issues. I don't pretend that the value for me of a meeting like this is what I have to say to you and then to run. Since as an organization, you've asked me to come and listen to your points of view, as well as to respond to your questions, I'm very happy to do that, and hope that from my position as a member of the subcommittee on HUD and related organizations, which term related organizations includes NASA programs, I hope I can be that resource person for you. But more importantly, I think it gives you a chance for me to relate to me your feelings about the federal government involvement in the space program, about your views on government versus private sector, the commercialization issue. Most importantly, I suppose, to all of you is the level of funding in these programs. From the standpoint of whatever you want to bring up about the space programs, I hope I can be responsive. If I can't be responsive in the way of responding to your questions, I hope I can at least be a good listener and take those views that you have as a society, audience, and membership to let me know your views. As you understand, Congress, as I indicated to you, I was trying to be here late in October when I thought we could adjourn. I suppose Congress is a little bit like each one of you as students cramming for finals. Congress, you know, was trying to rush through a budget agreement, which budget agreement I voted against, not because necessarily what it did or did not do to space programs, but mostly from the standpoint of how it would hurt economic growth at the same time raising taxes on Americans. And almost in the sense that raising taxes, you can satisfy the appetite of Congress to spend money. Well, it was that budget agreement that really, for all practical aspects, kept me from meeting with you in October, because it went till October the 27th. This budget agreement, probably being late, and the fact that we did not finish until October 27th, says something about Congress that probably you don't study in your political science courses here, but it's the fact that Congress never really makes a decision until you're at a crisis time, whether it deals with space programs or whether it deals with budget deadlines. You know, I can see it coming next year. We are supposed to meet on January the 3rd, and we will meet on January the 3rd, but nothing very seriously will get done in the Congress of the United States until probably after the President meets with his State of the Union message, and probably after a traditional February recess. So you see, again, I can see coming up next year, 1991, basic flaws that Congress has in the way it does business. That basic flaw is that we don't do enough during January or February, and we try to do it all during the last few months of the year. I'm glad you don't manage your university that way, or your space research programs that way, or you'd be in, wouldn't have, I guess I should say, you wouldn't have the good reputation that you have in these areas. The result of this whole process is bad for the economy, for the country, and for individual programs that we support, including the one that's on our agenda today. Our support for a forward-looking space policy will be tested in the near term, not just on the subject matter itself, the good or the bad of specific programs, but also it's going to be tested because we're in an era of large budget deficits, and Congress taking those extraordinary measures to get those budget deficits under control. So it would be wrong for me to talk about a space program to you without talking about some of the deficit issues that face us. Because the deficit is, in fact, an 800-pound gorilla of American politics. The question you can ask is, how many programs does it hurt? And the answer is true of any 800-pound gorilla aspect of any issue. It hurts everyone that it wants to. In an era of constrained budgets, the issue of what programs should be pursued by government and what space activities can and should be conducted by the private sector as an alternative, all of these have become highly controversial. But they're most often highly controversial, not because of the specifics of the issues dealing with the space programs, but because the space programs as a priority or non-priority within the federal budget, or where does it come in the prioritization of those issues. All in all, though, space programs didn't do too badly on the appropriation front. Now, for those of you that were hoping for 24% increases, as President Bush hoped for, then the fact that we went with only a 13% increase probably doesn't look very well to you. But there will be $1.7 billion more to spend in space programs in 1991 that wasn't there in 1990. The President made his request for a 24% increase to proceed with major projects such as the space station and the Moon-Mars initiative. In the latter case, this latter program was zeroed out entirely in the budget. While funds for the space station were $500 million less than the president had requested. However, at this point in the debate, 1991 versus 1988, the space station is an accepted fact by Congress, unlike in the previous year when it was so close that my vote on the conference committee was a deciding vote for moving ahead with the project when the chairman of the committee, then Senator Proxmire, now retired, was leading the charge for doing away with the space station. But the total 1991 figure will force NASA to stretch out or scale back several other programs. Still, I don't think that the 13% growth is not bad. And for those of you who have an agricultural background and see agricultural programs taking a 25% cut over the next 5 years from what they were otherwise going to cost, a 13% program ought to look pretty good. Now, it was just 37 years ago this January that the United States entered the space age. Today, we are reassessing what programs should be pursued by the government and what space activities can and should be conducted by the private sector. The recent malfunction of the Hubble Space Telescope and the grounding of space shuttles have raised questions about NASA's ability to carry out its plans for the 1990s. Some in Congress feel that we cannot justify spending billions of dollars in large NASA projects in a time of shrinking budget resources. And when the complexities of past projects have resulted in cost overruns, delays, and significant defects and failures. And let me say parenthetically at this point, from the standpoint of those things I just mentioned that are glaring shortcomings of recent NASA history, that doesn't single NASA out in any respect. Those of you who have followed, and I don't expect that many people follow everything that their senators do, but on the area of these very same areas of cost overruns, delays, and significant effects and failures in production, those are all common problems that we have with defense programs as well. And some of the very same things that are wrong within the Defense Department of the way it does business, to some extent, are shortcomings of the way NASA has done business. Now, my perception is that it's going to be easier to change the way NASA does business than the way the Defense Department does business. And not that it should be easier to do one or the other, and there would be more savings and benefit to the taxpayers of our country, the extent to which we could accomplish those changes in the Department of Defense. So I'm not beating on NASA today, because very much so, those have been projects of mine with the Department of Defense since 1983. The shuttle and Hubble flaws have raised questions about the reliability of the space shuttle, the effectiveness of NASA's management and quality control, and the future of NASA's planned large projects. Now, NASA responds that it has corrected past problems and should be judged on how it handles any future problems. Let me say also parenthetically here that, again, those of you who are really familiar with space, the federal government involvement in space, know that there's about five departments of government involved in some aspect of space programs. So again, we tend to go to the major research organization, NASA, to maybe find faults, but there are probably faults in the space programs of others as well. Because of questions raised about NASA's ability to manage and achieve its goals, Vice President Quayle, in a position he's been specifically assigned to by the President of the United States as Chairman of the National Space Council, Quayle has asked NASA Administrator Admiral Richard Truly to put together an outside task force to consider the long-term direction and the future of the space program. This panel will examine broad management issues and program content. The panel will examine organizational structure, planned activities, assurance of mission success, and adequacy of overall skill based on the workforce. We can get into any of these issues today, and indeed I look forward to your telling me your views, your private citizen, your student, those of you who are on staff here, how you respond to these and how you see them as constituents, because I think I need to know what you think about those that most deserve and merit the highest priority. Since the beginning of civilization, humankind has sought to explore the frontier and increase its knowledge of the world. Humans have endeavored to explore our world from the deepest oceans to the outermost boundaries of our solar system and beyond. We're all amazed at the recent new images of Venus sent to us via Magellan, discoveries that will tell us more about both Venus and its sister planet, our planet Earth. Today, there are unprecedented opportunities to expand the frontier of knowledge and to expand human presence and activity. The budget places a limit on these most exciting frontiers, so we must learn to deal with these budgetary limits. At the same time, we know that the exploration of space has benefits for the United States that go far beyond things that are easily quantifiable. There are specific payoffs in the form of new materials, technological discovery, and microgravity research. The eventual commercialization of space, if successful, will stimulate economic growth and improve life on Earth. And I suppose, again, let me digress just a minute. I suppose to some extent, it's very clear to some in Congress and the federal government and the private sector that without a doubt, there's no problems with commercialization in space. On the other hand, it's a fact of life that in some respects with Landsat, there's been some problems that have come about as a result of commercialization. So I think we still have to have some question mark there, but I hope it's a question mark that errs on the side of learning to rely and hope for success on privatization, as well as maintaining success within the public sector involvement in space programs. There has been a decided push on the part of the House of Representatives, very much on the side of privatization, because the House committee has put in its committee reports an overwhelming emphasis that it should move in that direction. But no price can be put on lifting the spirit. This is the non-quantifiable aspects of this. And what it does for us as a society, what it does to encourage us to move forward in the future, no price can be put on lifting the spirit of people everywhere, like that which occurred at the time of the Apollo landings on the moon, or the pride that we as Iowans feel about Lauren Shriver of Peyton, who commanded the Discovery mission, or the other Iowa astronauts, Pinky Nelson of Charles City, David Hilmers of DeWitt, Ronnie Cunningham of Creston. No value can be calculated for the wonder engendered by pictures of Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and in August of 89, of Neptune sent back over 1 million miles by Voyager. And no quantitative measure of any kind can capture the benefit of expanding human horizons, human dreams, and the human domain. The key to developing space successfully will be stable and sustainable funding for a balanced federal program of science applications and manned space activities. Of course, coupled with encouragement by the government of the development of the private sector of the commercial potential of space. While we can't overlook the setbacks, The U.S. space program has made major advances. In unmanned planetary exploration, U.S. spacecraft has made essentially a grand tour of the major planets of our solar system and have landed unmanned vehicles on Mars to explore its surface. In astronomy, U.S. orbiting observatories have given us a window on the stars and into the creation of the universe. In just 30 relatively short years, the progress of manned spaceflight has been amazing. The time from the first suborbital flight by Alan Shepard to the first steps by humans on another heavenly body, the moon, was less than a decade. This was followed by the developments of the world's only manned reusable space vehicle, the Space Shuttle. The benefits of space for the U.S. economy and society are numerous and substantial. For example, the satellite communications industry is a direct result of the development of space telecommunication technology. Live via satellite would not be possible today without the early federal investment in space. As evidenced by a wide variety of other advances, from new lightweight materials for aerospace and other applications, to life-saving breathing equipment used by firemen, to long-life micro-miniaturized electronics used in medical equipment such as pacemakers. The space program continues to create new business opportunities and to contribute to our economy, at the same time making life better for people that would not have so good of a life. Most recently, the shuttle Atlantis was launched on a final secret military mission to monitor Persian Gulf events in support of our troops there. Frankly, much of the future of our space policy will be resolved once we as a nation decide on the issues of space leadership. In other words, is it still important for the U.S. to be preeminent in space? During the space age for 30 years, the answer has always been an emphatic yes. But space has long since ceased to be a concern of only the United States and the Soviet Union, the European Space Agency, plus Japan, China, India, and Israel also have their own capabilities to launch satellites today. And the European Space Agency and Japanese programs are especially vigorous and highly competitive to both those of the Soviet Union and the United States. Thus, maintaining leadership no longer is a contest between the United States and the Soviet Union, but with other countries as well. For example, the European Space Agency clearly wants autonomy in space at some time in the future and plans to build a reusable spacecraft for carrying people into orbit. It is a real possibility that by the late 1990s, Europe will no longer be reliant upon other countries to take people into orbit. The question now is whether it is still important for the U.S. to lead in space overall, and whether or not it must lead in all areas. Future decisions on U.S. space policy and programs could be significantly affected by these answers. In his space policy address last year, President Bush stated that it is America's destiny to lead in space and his goals. Space station freedom and eventual bases on the moon and Mars would establish the United States as a preeminent spacefaring nation. Those goals are, because of the deficit, in real jeopardy. And it may even be agreement even in this room, even within the Iowa Space Society, your organization, of whether or not those being in jeopardy are serious or whether Congress made a serious error by not totally agreeing with President Bush. Those debates that you might have along that line are probably no different than the debates we have within the Congress of the United States. Whether we fulfill the vision of President Bush or whether other more immediate needs distract us is what the coming space debate is all about. We need to call upon America's best minds to help us, both at Iowa State and elsewhere, if we're to meet our goals with the resources available. I feel good knowing that there are so many Iowans interested and knowledgeable about space issues, people who are ready to engage in this debate. I look forward to hearing your ideas on the space program, particularly future decisions to be made. I welcome your input, whether it's orally now or whether you write to me. And remember, if you write to me, expect an answer. Don't only expect an answer from me, expect an answer from any of your elected representatives at the state, local, and federal level, because representative government's a two-way street. You communicate to us, we also have to communicate to you. Today, that's easy because we're together, as it was for me at noon with Iowa State University people in Waterloo, or it's going to be at 5 o'clock this afternoon when I go to a meeting that I have in Des Moines to speak to, a meeting of firm groups. So I want you to be a part of that debate. You can be a part of that debate. I welcome, and I'm sure every congressman and senator, Republican or Democrat from Iowa, welcomes your opinion on it. So I thank you for inviting me today, but more importantly, I thank you for being patient about 6 weeks till I could be here. Now, your first question or just your comments. I would really like to hear what people who have views on our space program feel about some of these issues. And don't be limited, please, just to the issues about space that I discuss. There's a lot of issues dealing with space that I haven't discussed that you might want to ask about, or you might want to put your opinion out about. Yes, sir.
Yeah, the aerospace industry is largely concentrated on the West Coast. What can we do to get the aerospace industry here in the Midwest and specifically here in Iowa?
Well, first of all, there's a major problem within NASA that has, well, I shouldn't say just NASA, maybe it's almost any federal bureaucracy. And I'm coming at this the long way. I suppose there's easier ways for me to answer your question, like saying, there's the high educational levels of Iowans, the work habits, the work ethic of Iowans, the fact that space building rental costs in California are so gigantic, and when long-term contracts run out, companies that are doing that work are going to move to places where buildings space is cheaper. But I think there's another major problem we have to deal with if we're really going to be successful in this area. And it's at the federal level, a problem with NASA. Now I'm getting back to where I started. They have tended to put grant money where grant money has gone before, as an example. So there's a bias against universities that haven't done a lot of space work and had a lot of federal space grants in the past. And we're trying to break that monopoly of a few major universities, both east and west. There might even be some Midwest, but I think of them in my mind concentrating in California and in New England and maybe a few places in Texas, but it doesn't matter. Generally, not missing the Midwest. So there's a certain point system. You make an application as a university. There's a certain point system that will give you extra points because you've already done some work in that area. So there's a bias against those universities that haven't done that. We need to break that bias to a considerable extent. And we are just now beginning to try to crack that in Washington. And we're just, to some extent, getting some universities in the Midwest having a greater concern about fighting hard for some of those federal dollars. And in a sense, communicating that view to congressmen and senators that probably activate congressmen and senators previously not activated or concerned, maybe not even realizing the problem or how it works. So, it's a circle that you go through. But we were able to, 1 year ago, and this was written up in the Iowa State Daily about the consortia of UNI, University of Iowa and Iowa State, getting some money that wasn't previously allocated, and And quite frankly, the arguments that I use when I talk to Admiral Truly about these things are this. That, you know, when you consider, and I'm not talking just about Iowa, although Iowa is preeminent in this area, but when you talk about Iowa, Wisconsin, Minnesota, just to, let's expand it to three states, how well we do as high school graduates on test scores. And maybe these aren't as good as they ought to be nationally, but they're still preeminent for the United States because we rank one, two, or three on most of these. And Iowa's usually one in a lot of them. That when you write off universities like Iowa and Minnesota and Wisconsin to some extent, where all the brains are going to in the first place, because we tend to educate a large number of Iowans at Iowa universities, and I'm sure it's true of Minnesota and Wisconsin, just think of the potential for research expertise and for opportunities to get the best people in teaching you're missing, because you give scores, extra points to universities that maybe also have good student bodies. But it seemed to me like you're limiting the pool that you're going to make use of in future decades. Okay, next. Yes, sir.
I was wondering, sort of a two-part question, why in this last budget battle was it so hard for Congress to get up the gumption to spend a little over $200 million for the Space Exploration Initiative, which was starting to be technology development for the Moon and Mars endeavors, and what will it take for Congress to start funding this program?
Well, a change of attitude on the part of the House of Representatives, and I don't say that just because I'm a senator, that's a fact of life. They zeroed out the program. So, you know, anything that's available is a result of compromise between the House and Senate, and more support in the Senate for it than in the House. So I suppose what you ask is not an easy answer, because it involves, you know, key people being key places and making decisions, you know. How the attitude of a Senator Garn, who is the only senator to have been on a shuttle mission, how hard he's willing to fight, because he's one of the few people really know and understand it and devote his life to it. And sometimes, you know, as one individual fighting a cause, you might wear out. Now, that doesn't mean he doesn't have a lot of help. But I'll tell you, it's a very complicated area, and so you rely considerably on people like that. That's maybe one reason why anything was preserved at all, you know. And how you are effectively able to challenge the House of Representatives, which also has good people, and they feel strongly about their views. But I guess the only answer I can give to you is keep up your requests flowing to Congress so that they know that the issue hasn't died out the grassroots. And just have to hope for the best. And but I mean, you're talking about trying to persuade Congress through the representative process that you do. See? Okay, next. Yes?
Do you think it's time to start large-scale cooperation with, say, the Soviet Union on space exploration?
Well, maybe I can't answer that yes or no, but I guess I could answer positively that I see tremendous advantage to both economies when, you know, they're going through worse budget situations than we are, and we're starting out with a stronger economy than they are. They have to divert more from military to economics than we do, because they're spending a higher percent of their GMP on military. You might say that also gives them more potential for improving their private sector, but I think that it's to our advantage to start looking in that direction. And And almost every day, you know, opportunities improve and receptivity is improved, even by the hardest core people within the Congress, you know. You're really talking about, maybe the real answer to your question is, the extent to which do we continue to build trust as we have over the last let's say 2 years. Maybe 4 years we started, but the last 2 years, really trust being built. And then a year ago now, when the East Bloc breaks up, you see real changes being made. And so you just gallop further trust. But It's the extent to which we continue to build trust. Now, sadly, that building a trust is probably related, and this could be considered a weakness, as long as he's in power, it's a strength to Gorbachev staying in office. You know, just think of the talk you hear every day about possibilities of famines and food riots in the Soviet Union this fall. If that encourages the ascendancy of the KGB and the military again, and you have another Cold War warrior like we had seven or eight of them before Gorbachev over since 1917, then we're in trouble. You know, I might answer the question differently at that point. But I have to say now that I'm very encouraged to be looking in that direction and do not find a mental block to doing that. But ask me that 4 or 5 years ago, and I probably would have said no. I think you had your hand up simultaneous.
Yes, sir. Consider, each space shuttle is a very complex machine, and at some point in its lifetime, several times during its lifetime, they're going to have to be taken off the line for extensive maintenance. Also consider that many of our future projects, like Space Station Freedom, require shuttle flights, a lot of shuttle flights. Do you support construction of a fifth space shuttle orbiter after the Endeavor is done?
Well, I suppose what you're asking, in order to make it the space station entirely efficient, as long as you've got all that money invested in the space station, that you'll be able to go to and from it as often to fully utilize it. That's the basis for your question? I think that I would say today, no, but I wouldn't say that forever, because I do support the space station. You understand that, and you heard me say in my remarks where 2 or 3 years ago my vote was a deciding vote in this effort when Senator Proxmire was trying to cut it out. We had a 9-7 vote that kept it intact. You know, so you know, down the road, once that investment's made, we're going to look at every way to make maximum use of it. You know, it's not like we were buying into a big question mark. It's a question now or tomorrow. And I guess I have to say, realistically, today, knowing the difficulty of maintaining what budget we did, 13% increases, and knowing that we're kind of locked into some limits, even though I spoke about $245 billion more that can be spent on domestic programs over the next 5 years, we're still locked into a 5-year decision that Congress has made. Now, within that 5-year decision, there are some changes that can be made from year to year, but under the procedure, if I offered an amendment that accomplished what you wanted to accomplish, and it was X number of hundreds of billions, or millions, or probably billion, a few billion dollars, I would have to say where the money's coming from. So that means you take it away from some other program and you increase taxes. Well, you see, prior to Graham Rudman, that was never possible. If I want to stand up and offer an amendment to accomplish what you want to, and I get 51 votes, that's all there is to it. That's one reason, though, why you don't have a lot of responsibility, or didn't previously have a lot of responsibility in the scheduling of money, because there's almost an environment that anything you wanted, you could have as long as you got the votes for it. Now, where you're going to get the money is part of the equation for the first time. So, you know, it brings another whole focus into the debate. Where do you get the money? So you're hurting some other cause as you take money away, or some segment of the economy is hurt as you try to raise taxes, see? Okay? So I probably didn't satisfy you very much, but the answer is, yes, but not now, probably, is the best way I can answer your question. Okay? I'll get you and then you. Go ahead.
With that budget juggling that you're talking about, where you take away from one program to help NASA, for instance, you mentioned, and this is that it's linked to HUD, NASA's linked with other domestic programs. How wise do you think that is?
Well, I'll tell you, it isn't only... that's just within our subcommittee. You know, I mentioned the name of the subcommittee, HUD and independent and other independent agencies. It's kind of a how do you divide up the work? among 14 subcommittees, the Appropriations Committee. This HUD and Independent Agency Subcommittee is one of 14 committees, subcommittees that determine all of the discretionary funding within the federal budget, which discretionary funding, by the way, is only about probably 25% of the entire federal budget. But how do you divide that up? And so you try to divide up the workload, and I suppose, you know, a few years ago, maybe a decade and a half ago, somebody decided this is how it ought to be divided up. I can say this, and maybe this is what you're getting at. If you really study it, you probably understand that some of what we call the 302B allocation, which under the budget law decides, you know, X number of dollars for the department or for the defense subcommittee and X number of dollars for the agriculture subcommittee, X number of dollars for HUD and independent related committees, and you go along that till you cover all of the project, all 14 committees. See, it tends for this reason to hurt our subcommittee more than some, because if you're under a mandate to cut across the board, we within our subcommittee, particularly in HUD, we have a lot of what are called mandated programs that just cannot be cut because of the demand out there is automatic in a sense that, you know, the money's going to be spent. So let's suppose you have a 5% across the board cut, but 50% of your programs are mandatory programs. That means the programs that are discretionary are going to take 10% cuts. And that has really, that aspect of it has really hurt space programs. Now, you know, that's within our subcommittee. So in a sense, if somebody could devise another scheme that would put space programs in some subcommittee where they didn't have such a high percentage of mandated programs, I guess I'd have to say space programs would probably be better off. But, you know, that isn't going to happen, and why it isn't going to happen is simply this, is because every subcommittee chairman, and the last 4 years they've been Democrats, but the 6 years before that they were Republicans. It doesn't matter whether you're Republican or Democrat, you got a certain authority under your within your subcommittee, you'll fight like heck to maintain it because there's a lot of power that goes with it. See? So it just doesn't seem to be realistic that you're going to get that allocation change. And somebody else probably doesn't want space programs because they may feel it hurts their mandated program. Well, you've got some people in the subcommittee that really understands the programs and are supportive of the programs. See, so that's the offset. You know, you got a Jake Garn there to look out for you. Okay, yes, you're next. And then I'll get you, sir.
Take a comment on a related area.
Go ahead.
Thanks. Are really concerned about the prospect of war in the Middle East. And I would simply ask you as a member of Congress to do whatever you can to prevail on the administration to, by all means, prevent that. I, for one, am not trusting of our reasons for being there. But certainly it's not about democracy. I think oil figures in. I think it also has to do with us avoiding the perestroika that Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union are doing by continuing our militarized economy and our presence in many parts of the world. And this, certainly, Saddam Hussein's action has given a pretext for us to continue this kind of economy and resist the important changes.
Yeah.
And I would simply ask you to work with all your might to help us to make those kind of changes and to prevent the outbreak.
Yeah, I'll just give one very short response. I think it's legitimate what you say, so I don't detract from the debate on the issue of space, which is my reason for being here, and I don't want to infringe upon my host. If to the extent to which we ought to try every diplomatic, political, and economic means, and use of military always ought to be a last resort. I agree with you, and then further, I think that that I want to, the thing that I'm going to be looking for is the extent to which in which the embargo, we know that isn't accomplishing anything, and not only isn't accomplishing anything, if it might be at a, that might be questionable, that that there's still imminent danger to national security or, you know, the life to world society generally as a result of it, you know. In other words, the extent to which containment might be a legitimate policy, I guess I see we've had 2 months of containment in the Persian Gulf area compared to 45 years of containment with the Soviet Union since World War II. It seemed to me like it would dictate, you know, being a little patient to see if the embargo works. See, so I'll let it go at that. Okay, let's see, who, you, yes?
I just wondered, can you give an example of the mandated programs you were describing that have to be funded?
Well, I probably ought to give you a dozen, but let me give you one, because I'm not sure I can give you a dozen off the top of my head, but there would be a housing program called Housing Program Section 8, where we enter into 40-year contracts with builders to use their own private money to build housing for 40 years with the idea that we will use it for poor people. And so you got to honor those contracts, see? Yeah. Yes?
One more quick one. As far as funding for NASA that is locked into the VA cut, and it's very difficult to find more money put in NASA as well as other programs, how receptive would you be as far as innovative ways to raise money, either the public sector, the private sector, or commercial sector, to fund money into space programs in NASA independent of VA cut?
Okay. I think I understand your question. If I don't, stop me. If your question is philosophically, am I encouraged? Would I encourage partnerships between private and government on space programs? The answer is yes. And because you see that.